Good day, everyone. Thank you very much for this opportunity to talk to you a bit about stereotactic procedures in the developing world. I'm Nico Enslin, and I'm a neurosurgeon in Cape Town, primarily doing pediatric neurosurgery and with a special interest in functional neurosurgery. So we all know that there's clearly a big difference between Europe and the modern developed countries in the West, and countries like Africa and India. And this is a slide that very nicely illustrates how different we are, and we have to innovate and make a plan. The slide doesn't project very well, but you can see that there is many places all over the world where things are much different than they are in the West and in the modern world. And my talk today will specifically lift out some of these differences, specifically with regards to stereotactic neurosurgery and biopsies as a principle of that. My mentor and head of my department, Professor Fegan, in his dissertation in 2009, wrote that no neurosurgeon who looks at a CT scan showing a lesion deep within the brain, whether it's an abscess to be tapped or a tumor that needs a biopsy or a cyst that needs drainage, should have to undertake this today without having the option of using a stereotactic instrument to guide their hand, or by using a so-called free hand technique. And I 100% agree with it, and I'm sure we all do, but we also know that not every country and not every neurosurgeon has access to modern techniques and to the equipment that we have, that we always learn about at conferences and that we can use in big, well-equipped units. The sad reality is that, like Professor Ramamurthy said in 2004, it's simply not true in large parts of Africa, Asia, and South America, that have not enjoyed these benefits of progress and improvement. Stereotactic equipment is still a niche market, and the cost of the equipment, the software, and the applications are still very high. So we need to focus on other alternatives, and I'm going to try to shed some light on what the other options is in developing countries like mine. We need to modify certain techniques. There's generations of neurosurgeons who are finding their feet today in a world of neurosurgery where neuronavigation robots are standard. And we lose that ability to really plan or to have that three-dimensional map of the brain in our minds. And that can cost us dearly often, where our patients do not have access to the care because of our own lack of skills or lack of development. And we need to keep on working at that. And also, we need to remember that equipment can fail at crucial moments. It's no use of having this wonderful stereotactic planning assistance program. And in a developing country like Africa and India, we often have interruptions in our electricity feed at crucial times during surgery. So, or the equipment breaks and it takes us months to get it back from the company, which is always overseas, that has to fix it. So we need to have a plan B and a plan C even to give our patients the appropriate care. So stereotactic neurosurgery is not only this. It's not only robots and all these very expensive equipment. The basic principles of stereotaxy will remain the same always. You need to identify the location of a point, a specific point, within the three dimensions. So within a X, a Y, and a Z plane. And as long as you can do that, you can reach that target with relatively good accuracy always. So our role should always be to identify that point within the three stereotactic planes. Once you have that co-registration, so if you have any other imaging to your availability, you need to co-register it and lay it over that map that you're going to target. One can also include this in your mind co-registration, so even in your mind's eye, to identify where the vessels are, where the ventricles are, and where your target is in relation to this superficial anatomy that you're looking at when you look at the scalp. Then you have to choose a target within that stereotactic space. Again, you have to identify it in an X, a Y, and a Z plane. Important to remember that stereotactic surgery is not only limited to deep brain stimulation. Yes, that's the big driving force of the technology today, but we need to know that there's other things that we do and we can do more safely by using these stereotactic principles as well. So for placement of stents or shunts or reservoirs, now it might sound difficult to comprehend for someone in a developed country, but remember about more than 60% of hydrocephalus in Africa is caused by post-infectious hydrocephalus. So we often deal with multiloculated hydrocephalus or deformed ventricles, where it's not just easy to use the superficial landmarks to get the shunt into a ventricle. Craniopharyngiomas or cystic lesions that needs intra-lesion therapy. All of them need stereotactic placement of a reservoir or a stent. To biopsy certain lesions, to determine whether it's infective, so drain an abscess, for instance, or to determine if it is a tumor, actually. Tuberculosis in developing countries mimics a lot of tumors, and we mistreat the patient by starting them on chemotherapy or radiotherapy, even worse. If it's tuberculosis, we need to start them on antibacterial medication that's appropriate for TB. And then to differentiate demyelinating lesions and others, again, they mimic, big mimickers of tumors, and as well as some infectious lesions like tuberculosis. Also, difficult to reach abscesses, also can use these principles in your aspiration of them. So it's a skill that you need as a neurosurgeon, independent of whether you're ever going to do any functional neurosurgery. You need to be able to be comfortable with stereotactic procedures. It's not only limited to those expensive systems, and I'll show you some examples of why I say that. Again, Graham Fegan and another colleague of ours in Cape Town developed a system in 2009 called the Cape Town Stereotactic Pointer, where they realized the need to do stereotactic precision biopsies of tumors, lesions, and infections. But the hospitals where we work cannot afford the expensive stereotactic frames that are available in the rest of the world. So they made a low-cost, high-precision instrument that can be appropriate for developing countries where cost is really restrictive. And this is the Cape Town Stereotactic Pointer. And you can see over here that there's a basic fiducial system where these fiducial rings over here are physically sutured to the patient's skull on a predetermined safe entry point as a trajectory to the tumor. The patient then gets taken for a CT scan, and I'll show in my next slide, I'll show you some more examples of this. And then onto those fiducial rings that is sutured to the patient's skull, a frame then gets applied once the patient is in theater, and this rigid box is the phantom where trajectory is planned and confirmed. So this little ring on top here, that ring gets sutured to the fiducial ring that's on the patient's skull, and then that will then give us the specific coordinates. And again, in an X, a Y, and a Z plane, you can then set the instrument that mounts to this ring, as you can see here. This instrument here gets mounted onto that ring, the fiducial ring, and then a probe, a rigid instrument, can be placed through that, and it has a very high accuracy of about 2 millimeters, which is appropriate for biopsies and for aspiration of difficult to reach tumors, as an example. Very innovative. Important thing is it's very low cost, and it comes in a small package. It travels very lightly, and in the next few slides I'll show you where a colleague of ours, Dr. Mahmoud Qureshi, in Kenya, Nairobi, literally travels around Africa, all through Africa, with his bag. In the one hand, he has a mobile endoscope to doing third ventriculostomies, and the other hand, he has this Cape Town stereotactic pointer, and you can really give world standard, world class quality neurosurgical care by having those two instruments. So the goals of the Cape Town stereotactic pointer is to have a visible reference frame outside of the brain, something that you can suture to the skull, the scalp, as I mentioned. To have an imaging system that will be able to see both the reference system and the target within the brain. And then to have a mechanical system that will enable one to reach the target based on the external reference system with good accuracy of about 2 millimeters. That is appropriate accuracy for these types of procedures. It's definitely not enough for deep brain stimulation or deep brain lesioning, where the targets are small and accuracy more than that is required, but for stereotactic biopsies, it is appropriate. And this is an example of an ideal case for the Cape Town stereotactic pointer. Difficult to reach midbrain lesion, might be a tumor, might be tuberculosis in our setting, it would be very common. So we need to know what that is before we empirically start treatment for the patient or decide on whether surgery is necessary because it's a difficult to reach target, as you all know. So these are slides that courtesy of Dr. Qureshi. So firstly, the patient will undergo a CT scan because MRI scans is not freely available in Africa. CT scan with that ring sutured to the patient's scalp. This is the image that you then get. So to put the tumor or the lesion, the target, in reference to those rings. The patient will then go to theater. General anesthesia will be applied. The surgical drapes are applied, and then the coordinates on this frame is planned with the basic computer program that they developed themselves as well, the team who developed the Cape Town stereotactic pointer. This frame is then mounted onto that fiducial ring that's sutured to the patient's scalp. A burl gets then gets made, and the trajectory and the depth is already predetermined with this squared frame, and the aspiration needle or the biopsy needle is then placed, and the aspiration biopsy is done safely in this matter. And this works very, very effectively in Africa or in India as well. There's multiple units in India that uses it as well. And this is then the basic planning software. Easy, very cheap software compared to all other systems, and it's perfectly made for resource-scarce areas such as in Africa, India, and other parts of South America. And it's used with very good accuracy. So Dr. Qureshi introduced this into East Africa. He started using it at the end of the 1990s already. And he's been able to provide outreach stereotactic procedures during humanitarian missions that he runs all over East Central Africa, as well as other parts of Southern Africa. And he's at this stage that he shared the slides with me a year or two ago. It was already 180 cases that has been created at that point. So most of these cases that they use it for, that Dr. Qureshi uses it for, is for biopsy. So he does a craniotomy, and then he can also then does the biopsy through that, but also stereotactic craniotomies and placements of catheters using the Cape Town stereotactic pointer. For instance, difficult to reach craniopharyngiomas, even very small ventricles can be cannulated like this for hydrocephalus. And he used this to assist in training of other specialists in neighboring countries like Tanzania. And it's a very popular system. There's also multiple people that uses it in Kenya, with very high success rates. And this is just a slide again to show their setup that they use in Kenya and on their outreaches. Very small mobile system, packs in a bag that's smaller than the average small suitcase, and you can easily travel with it in rough terrain like in Africa. this is the more commonly used type of frame. I've just used an example of the Lexel frame, but you know that there are various different examples of frames. And on the Stereotactic Networks, other talks among the DBS part of it, there are multiple examples of different frames that one can use. And this is still the gold standard, and probably the accuracy of it is much better than the make-do systems that we have to use in the developing countries often. And if you're going to do a stereotactic lesion or placement of a neurostimulator, I think this is the gold standard, and one has to go for one of the fixed indicated stereotactic frames. There's also alternative methods of obtaining a biopsy, and using these principles of stereotaxy is very important in a country that is still developing, where you cannot always have a stereotactic frame that you need to use. So I'm going to show some examples of doing frameless guided biopsies. Ultrasound guided, most hospitals all over the world, if there's any gynecological service, they will have an ultrasound machine. And this is very important to remember, especially for resource constrained environments. There's always an ultrasound machine somewhere in the hospital, and we can use that, and we need to be very comfortable with that in performing biopsies and placement of catheters as well. So I'll discuss that a bit. And then just placing scalp fiducials and then doing a CT scan if you have access to that. You can then triangulate an approach to a tumor or to a lesion that you want to biopsy. It's not adequate for very small lesions, but for centimeter and bigger diameter lesions, you can easily reach them like this. Open biopsies or freehand, where we're using landmarks. And this is so important, because this will always be the fail-safe. If our technology or our equipment fails, we always need to know our neuroanatomy and landmarks well enough that we can guide ourselves to any lesion anywhere in the body, in the brain, with safety and accuracy. And then, often forgotten tool, but a major revelation in neurosurgery came with the use of endoscopy and direct visualization through the endoscope can also be used to biopsy tumors with very great accuracy. And it's wonderful for those deep seated periventricular tumors that we cannot reach if you don't have a stereotactic system. But remember to use the endoscope is often very helpful. This is an example again. This is Dr. Qureshi and my friend Edwin Mugere, that works at Aga Khan Hospital in Nairobi. So to remind you that neuronavigation with a frameless system yields very good accuracy. So for lesions above a centimeter in diameter, you can safely plan biopsy of that lesion by doing a preoperative scan, whether it's CT scan or MRI scan, as in this example, using fiducial markers, and then co-registering the patient, determining where your lesion is in the three planes, and then plan your approach and your trajectory using a frameless system if you have a neuronavigation system like this. Ultrasound guided, like I said previously, always available. It can be done through an open fontanelle, so a small child less than two where there's an open fontanelle. Wonderful, because you can use the fontanelle as a natural window into the brain with the ultrasound probe. But remember, even in adult patients, you don't need to do a massive craniotomy. You just need a craniotomy that's large enough for your ultrasound probe to fit through it, to have a window of access into the brain. And then you can very easily and very reliably, lesions up to a centimeter size again, you can get very good accuracy of, because as you can see your biopsy probe or your needle travel through the brain en route, you can see ventricles, you can see major blood vessels. So with appropriate planning and a bit of experience, you can really get very good accuracy biopsies using the ultrasound guided technique as well. Important that there's also burr hole size ultrasound probes that are more expensive, but I know many units in Germany, for instance, place their catheters for ventricular shunt placements with the use of an ultrasound probe that is small enough to fit into the burr hole that they make, and that ultrasound probe then even has a little groove on the one side where you literally slide the shunt probe or the shunt, a catheter, onto that ultrasound probe. You put it 100% in parallel in the plane of the ultrasound view point, and that can then help you to place catheters very, very safely as well. And these are examples. The one here in the bottom right of your screen shows how beautiful we can see the anatomy in a small infant that has an open fontanelle. You can see ventricles, midline, any lesion, choroid plexus even in this picture you can see nicely. But top right, you can see how one can very nicely see and differentiate various areas of a tumor, the correlation on the MRI scan as well. So it's easy then to target your biopsy on that, and you can safely avoid the midline, avoid entering the brain too deeply, and take accurate biopsies, and even watch for complications. So check whether there isn't any bleeding once you take a biopsy. So in adults, remember, make a small craniotomy, and you can use your ultrasound probe as a very, very effective guidance system for biopsies as well. Again, with the principles of stereotaxis, as long as you have enough points to triangulate a trajectory where those points will meet in the X, Y, and the Z plane, that is very effective, and that is still stereotactic use of biopsies. The important thing there is just that you need at least a CT scan, because you'll need to determine the depth. So once you've determined your triangular point, your point of entry, and your trajectory that you're going to aim at, it will be a freehand technique as an example here, use your CT scan to determine the depth, because you don't want to enter into the basal ganglia, for instance, in this patient, or into the ventricles. So planning is very, very important. And then don't ever forget that, yes, there is wonderful stereotactic ways of biopsying this, but if you are in an area where you do not have access to any stereotactic planning software or equipment, and you have an endoscope, even in worse scenarios, if it's a urological scope that can be sterilized, once you have access into the ventricle, you can clearly see where the tumor is bulging into the ventricle in the top right. You can then do cautery of the ependymoma, and you can safely do biopsy and control hemorrhage through that as well. And again, it even allows you to do a septostomy in a patient like this and a third ventriculostomy at the same time to treat the hydrocephalus as well while you are awaiting your biopsy results. So don't forget the use of an endoscope. Always important, remember that there's risks and complications. The risks with stereotactic biopsies is hemorrhage. The danger is we often do these biopsies very deep in the brain, so the price we pay for uncontrolled hemorrhage is big. Patients suffer immensely, so we have to take care to avoid hemorrhage always, and my next slide will show you what to do. You can have, because it's again small biopsies that you take in a stereotactic way, you can have non-represented specimens, so multiple biopsies is important. Make sure you plan where to take your biopsies. Don't always aim for the center of the lesion. Often that's the necrotic part of a tumor. That junction between normal and abnormal is often safer. That's where you have the dysplastic cells that are still dividing, and that's where you're going to get your diagnosis most likely. Wrong side surgery, check and check and check again. Check with other people that your scan and the patient correlates, it's a correct patient, and that you are 100% sure you are biopsying the correct side. Always remember that causing vascular injury can lead to strokes in patients, and then neurological injury if you damage the corticospinal tract or the basal ganglia or the internal capsule or parts of the brain stem. So planning is extremely important before you start doing stereotactic biopsies or any procedure for that matter. So how do you avoid complications? Planning, planning, and planning. Plan where your craniotomy is going to be. Plan that your trajectory will be through safe, non-elegant brain tissue if it's possible. Limit your entry to sulci. That's where the vessels are. Also, that's where CSF is going to be lost, so you will get brain shift, accuracy decreases. Avoid vessels. Important, also avoid cortical vessels with your entry. So plan your entry point around the vessels as well. Don't go through a cortical vein and then have a massive subdural bleed afterwards. and the biopsy, then you've caused more harm than good. So plan your trajectory according to the vessels. Avoid losing CSF because that will cause brain shift and your accuracy will be detrimentally affected. Avoid the ventricles. Again, you will lose CSF and your brain will shift away. Consider structures that's deep to the biopsy. What am I going to hit if I do extend my biopsy depth by a millimeter or two? Always look at that. Don't aim for something that's right on top of a vessel. Change your trajectory, for instance. And meticulous coordinate calculation. Double check it. Use your software frequently. Play around with it. Practice how to use it. And have someone check your coordinates with you always. And then as well, the transfer point from your coordinates checking to the patient in theater, that needs to be double-checked again and again. And your frame coordinates needs to be double-checked again. Can never check enough. Always use a sterile technique and good quality stereotactic imaging. So thin slices, enough slices, multiple slices in the appropriate planes. That is what is needed. Always MRI is the gold standard, but in developing countries, a good quality CT scan with contrast even can help you, and you can really get on very far in doing stereotactic procedures such as biopsies and shunt or catheter placements. Always be aware of the vessels. If you do a CT scan, remember always do a contrasted scan as well so that you have angiogram-related pictures. And not only the arterial phase, beware of the veins. Always look at the veins. When you plan your entry, as well as planning your trajectory towards a target, always try every single thing you can to avoid vessels, avoid the veins especially. So in conclusion, we should never let the lack of expensive equipment get in the way of good quality medical care and diagnostic principles. And that counts for everywhere in the world. But we should also never ever take shortcuts and let the patient suffer because we have to make a plan. I think we can make plans to get by the resource constraints that we have in developing countries, but there's multiple steps and techniques, like I've discussed now, that should be used and should be safely applied to make sure that we can give best in the world care for every patient, because it's a basic human right to have good quality access to medical care everywhere in the world. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope this is informative, and please watch this in combination with the other videos that's on the Stereotactic Network as well. Thank you very much.